Hello and welcome back to the GOM TV Pro Game Team Exhibition. This is Nick Tasteless Plot broadcasting to you from Seoul, Korea, the motherland of esports, and even more so the motherland of StarCraft. I am very excited to be casting this next match. We are going to have Dark Elf versus Pure, a Terran versus Protoss on the map Katrina. I am not sure who's going to win this game. Of course, Katrina is a map that a lot of people feel do favor Protoss, unless your name is Flash, and you know what an armory is, then it could be the other way around. However, for I think most Protoss players, even the good ones, they do have a little bit of an edge. At the same time, I do find that Dark Elf is a little bit of a better player than Pure, so Dark Elf may have the skill advantage, while Pure has the map advantage. It could go either way. Fox is up one game after that last win, but CJ is still in the lead with those first two wins. Of course, we saw an incredible game with Effort versus Hero, the Zerg versus Protoss on Andromeda, a very long, drawn-out game that really kind of came out to Effort simply engulfing the map too much, and it really was a Hero on the run. Even though he had some more map dominance at the mid-game, it just took over, and Effort really came out on top. An impressive game. The next game, Sky High versus Baby, the Little League match of the tournament, but a very exciting game and a top level game nonetheless. It just looks like Sky High came out with a well orchestrated transitioning rush from the very beginning that eventually Baby could not keep up with and had to GG out when the Wraiths came in with Cloak and there was simply no turrets or academy. And of course, our previous game, NBS and Orion on the CJ team, a Protoss and Zerg duo against the Fox team, The Rock, a Protoss player, and Roro, a Zerg player with a funny name on the map, Hunters. And that was a very exciting game as well. A game where right off the bat, Fox came in there with some very good closing in maneuvers and managed to pick off the spawning pool of Orion. And from there on out, Orion was unable to recover in the Zergling count. It became a lot of Zerglings and Zealots duking it out. But eventually, the Rockout macroed NBS and Roro, easily outproduced his opponent, Orion. And they both came out on top. Here we are getting a shot of Dark Elf, who is in fact a Korean male and not a Dark Elf. Do not be confused, but he is a very strong player. He is 11-5, not the biggest pro gaming record, but one that clearly indicates he's accomplished and a force to be reckoned with. He has played in the Pro League and performed well there. He has 3-1 against Protoss players, showing that he is not a weak TVPer. It's also probably one of the more popular new pro gamers or new faces on the pro gaming scene that you will see around. And I know he's popular not only in Korea, but outside of Korea as well. Here is the player, here is the player Pure. Pure is 6-5 for an all-time pro record, but versus Terran, he is 1-0. Representing Fox, there's a lot of weight on his shoulders. If he loses this, Fox will be out of the tournament. If he wins this, we will go into an ace match, and I can't wait to see if that will happen. Pure is, of course, certainly not a bad player. He has experience just as Dark Elf does, but does he have enough to take on a player who is clearly more consistent than him? The map will probably favor Pure, as the architecture of it makes for carrier rushing a very high likely probability. And Dark Elf is clearly aware of that, so the odds of us seeing carriers are very high. Occasionally we do see different techniques used to make the player think that the opposing player is actually going carriers, when in fact there's some type of quick rush coming up. We do see fast nexus sometimes, so we could see this game go in a lot of different ways, but the longer it goes, the harder it gets for the Terran. Stay tuned.
Thank you.
The game has begun. There's no turning back now. All the practice comes down to this moment where they're representing their teams in a GOMP TV Pro Game Team exhibition. We, of course, have Pure at the bottom and Dark Elf at the left. With that being said, I think that the positioning of these spots could make for a very interesting game. Dark Elf's main expansion, the one he's most likely to take, in fact, the one I am 100% sure he will take first, is located at the bottom left, which could become very susceptible to carriers. Also know that the far right side of the map is pretty much purest to dominate. So Dark Elf is going to have a very well-calculated build. I'm curious to see if he's going to go with the Flash build, the only one that Flash ever seems to do in Terran versus Protoss, where he gets that fast armory, which seems to melt carrier interceptors like ice cream on a warm summer day. Anyway, actually even faster than that. It's like ice cream like in the sun. I don't even know how else to describe that build, but it completely dominates carriers, yet it is such a difficult build to execute, and there are so many things that can go wrong with it. Dark Elf may give up this opportunity and instead go for something else which is more within his style. There's really no one right way to play the map, although there are a few wrong ways to do it, and hopefully he will not do that. Going with the early Wallen, as we can see, he will probably get that up before the Protoss manages to scout him, giving him a bit of an advantage. We did not see a fast command center for Dark Elf. Dark Elf probably feeling that he might as well just play it safe. Losing this game would send it straight into the ace match, which is probably something he does not want to deal with, something his coach does not want to deal with, nor do the other players. If they can come out with a 3-1 victory, it will be good for him. Meanwhile, Pure, going for the fast Nexus, an incredibly common build on this map, and one that is very easy to pull off because the Nexus is in the back of the main. Meanwhile, if anybody is going to rush it, they're going to have to deal with the front of the Protoss base, and that fast Nexus will remain untouched. It does appear as though Dark Elf will spot that fast Nexus pretty fast. He's moving that scouting SCV out towards, luckily for him, the location where his opponent is. It's a four-player map, so he did have the opportunity to possibly scout the wrong spot and find him last. But instead, no excuse me, he is going to scout cross spots, which is not entirely uncommon. Many times, players have very different builds if their opponents are in a cross spot location rather than one of the adjacent locations. Because they are so far away, they may go for an even faster expansion. We could see a lot of different things. Right now, we can tell that Dark Elf will be going for that fast Nexus, though, because he does only have one SCV on the Vespian Gas. Presumably, Dark Elf will now scout the bottom because, oh man, Pierre's got to get those probes money. Okay. So at this point in time, Dark Elf will indeed scout the bottom because he did see the probe. The angle at which it was scouting from would indicate that, in fact, it was coming from the bottom of the map. Now Dark Elf going to move over there. Pure not too sure exactly where his opponent is. Probably confused by the fact that Dark Elf came from such an obscure angle. It's pretty rare to do that cross-spot scout. Although I believe we've seen that twice already in this tournament. Or at least in this event today. So that's rather interesting. There's a shot of the CJ coach eagerly awaiting the possible win of this match, which could bring his team home so he could drink the soju that he likes so much. And I'm not saying that because it's just him. I'm saying that because all Koreans love soju. It looks like the Cybernetics Corps is upgrading the Dragoon range. This is a pretty typical fast expo build. Two gates. He might get one zealot out, or he might wait and actually save those minerals to get two extra probes and instead just keep it with the Dragoons. I think that might be the wiser decision because the odds of Terran rushing you on this map are so low. The Marine sneaks out. The probe cannot fit through that wall, and probe will have to back off. And he did, in fact, get that first zealot out. One other thing to note is that I have seen some Protoss players actually do a fake Cybernetics Corps, Dragoon range rush, when in fact they're upgrading air weapons, and right when they pick off the scouting SCV, they start to get the Stargates out, and by the time they have carriers, they do have that plus to attack. I'm not sure if that's what Pierre's doing. More than likely, he's getting the Dragoon range upgrade, because that's simply put more typical. He's now driven the probe back out again. A good Protoss player such as Pure always makes sure that they can keep that probe right outside of their opponent's base, so they have a good idea of whether or not their opponent is pushing forward. And it does look as though Dark Elf is going to be moving towards that expansion. Well, I should say main, but at least pushing out to attempt to apply some pressure. I question how effective this will be considering. But whoa, hold that thought. It does look as though Pure is actually going around and may not end up directly engaging these forces. However, he's going to have to be very, very careful because Dark Elf could very easily lose his entire army with it being so vulnerable in the center. He does not want to engage any mines. The odds of the Protoss going to fast Robo Bay are not quite as likely on this map. Generally, the Zealot is in the army for the purpose of drawing mines. It takes 3 hits to kill the Zealot with a mine rather than the 2 hits it takes to kill the Dragoon due to the difference in damage types. Ah! And unfortunately for Pure, 4 of those Dragoons have lost all of their shields. Shields are down. And he did, in fact, get the Robo Bay up, so we are seeing a pretty gradual tech. We might see a Reaver. That would not be a bad idea, considering the close proximity of Dark Elf's expansion. It is very vulnerable to air, and after the Reaver, we could see Carriers. That's what I would probably do in this position. We'll see what Pure does. Either way, massing up a large ground army is not necessarily that effective, because it's very difficult to engage the Terran in the valleys while he pushes. Putting the Dragoons at the back of the Nexus, he is somewhat weary of a possible dropship opener, and he will in fact be going for the Reavers, which would be a healthy, gradual tech towards the Carriers. And look at this, Dark Elf sensing to some extent that his opponent is probably teching to Carriers or teching to Reavers, has decided to make a command center over at his next expansion. And this is a pretty smart move. We see a lot of Terran players do now. They pretty much know that the Protoss is not going to go for the ground army due to its ineffectiveness, and instead take that expansion so that they can have the Goliaths necessary to engage those Carriers. Reaver going to come out very soon, and it seems as though Dark Elf does have his StarCraft senses tingling and is already making some turrets to possibly engage that type of drop. Clearly, these are two very good players. We're going to have to see how their builds unfold to really decide who's actually doing the better build, because right now they're both doing it right. Like most Protoss players, Pure has put that Robo Bay and the Stargates in a location which is the least likely for Terran players to expand, although by today's standards, good Terran players will actually scan that spot first. Normally Terran players scan over the Nexus. It just seems to be where the Terran scans so many times, especially on this map. Protoss players build the Carriers in between those two spots. I'm not sure how effective this is. Many times I've seen good Protoss players actually build the Carriers in a completely other location on the map. However, if that spot is spotted and it's taken out, then the Carriers prove to be ineffective. It's kind of a difficult decision to make on where you're going to do that. Meanwhile, Shuttle's on the move. But it was flown over a mine, and I'm sure Terran will be ready. Here he comes now with the Reavers, and it looks like he may be rushing up here with the Dragoons, and I question if Dark Elf has overextended himself. Reaver will now fire onto these tanks, and it does appear as though, oh my god, but he lost the Reaver, and it's blundered this entire attack. If he had kept the Reaver alive, this could have been a different story. But here come a few more Dragoons up the ramp. And while this tank is rather soft, I do believe the SCVs will manage to repair it in time. Nope, I was wrong. It has been picked off, but the Dragoon will not back out. Both players have kind of been reset, so to speak. Neither has a very large ground army. Carriers are on the way. However, Pure losing that ground army will make the Carrier timing a bit more vulnerable to a push. However, 4 Gateway Dragoon and 2 Stargate Carrier, not necessarily an unsafe build. Many Protoss players actually make the other Nexus by now, so instead he spent those additional minerals on the extra gateway. This is a rather, it's not necessarily foolproof, but it's at least somewhat safe to a counter push. Meanwhile, the scanner's up. This is where Dark Elf will scan in what is most likely the location where the Carriers are. He will then decide whether or not it's time to push. Hopefully, when he scans, Pure's Carriers will not have popped out. That way, Pure can hide those Carriers from the possible scan error. air weapons is being upgraded at the cybernetic score, as we can see as well. And now is the phase in which Terran's economy has caught up to himself, and he throws up a bunch of factories, upgrading out of two armories, but it does appear that the build was somewhat different than the Flash build. He will, of course, need to get those armories no matter what. Any good Terran player would have done that by now. And there's one carrier out. He needs to move that carrier, however, pretty soon to kind of deceive his opponent a little bit more about how many interceptors he does have. More factories up now for the Terran, and eventually we're going to see a lot of Goliaths coming out of all of those. Terran does seem to have a very strong ground army, and Dark Elf could quite possibly walk over the Protoss if the Protoss does not get four carriers out in time, and right now I only saw one. Attempting to test his opponent's defenses to see if he could sneak a shuttle in there. He takes a look around, but no, he will not be able to infiltrate anything in that area. Shuttle softened up and will be more vulnerable to Goliath. He needs to transfer probes now, and I'm talking about Pure, of course, to that Nexus, because it will finish in time. It does appear that we have, I believe that's two carriers. It could have been a possible late pylon that caused the other carrier to come out a little bit later. Meanwhile, Dark Elf is continuing to mass up. There will be a critical moment, generally based off what his food limit is at, where he will come out of his base and start the push. However, I do believe Dark Elf is waiting too long, and time is money in a game like StarCraft. We may see a possible Reaver drop here. No, he needs to back out now because the Goliath will chase that shuttle out. Had he lost that shuttle, that would have triggered the Terran push already, and Terran would have left. However, I do believe the Dark Elf may be waiting too long. The longer he waits, the more carriers will be out in the map, and the harder it will be for him to deal with that. Carriers can run away endlessly on this map. They'll never run out of backdoors to retreat through because this map has so many valleys. And with that being said, I'm pretty sure that the plus one upgrade for those carriers is going to prove to be even more effective. Note, though, that the ground army for our friend Pure is very small, and the 1-1 upgrade is finished, and that was indeed the trigger, and a good trigger that was for Dark Elf. I question if Pure has the units necessary to take this on, but four carriers is about enough for an early game holdup of a Terran push. But again, the 1-1 upgrade will make them that much more effective. I don't know how much more effective the shuttle will be. Unfortunately, he didn't lose that Reaver. The Reaver, of course, makes it much easier to hold off a push like that. And here he comes now, taking that high ground spot. Meanwhile, Protoss is going to go around the back for a counterattack to that location. Carriers retreating all over to this middle section on the map. And here comes the Terran now with the Reaver dropping and now taking out an SCV. SCVs. And unfortunately that... he might lose this Reaver. He needs to pick it up. He did lose the Reaver. And now Dark Elf is going to try to close in. And unfortunately for Pure, he is controlling his army in a pretty sloppy fashion. But of course, this is all just an attempt by Pure to buy more time to get more carriers. And the more carriers she gets, the harder it is for the Terran to deal with. Some more carriers. Actually, the same amount of carriers, but I believe two more are about to spawn out of those star gates. Here he comes now, though. He does have a sizable ground army who should not be attacking the gateway, though. That is not a threat at this moment, as is it ever. Here he comes, though. Now, he has to control the carriers with the utmost precision, otherwise Dark Elf will simply walk over him. He should back those Dragoons out right now, because all they will do is draw tank fire, and there's more than enough tanks to take out those Dragoons as it is. Microwave farther back, he needs to snipe a few more Goliaths, but no, he may be going for the tanks instead. And here he is now with those Dragoons and those Zealots attempting to draw that fire. Does Dark Elf still have enough Goliaths if this push fails? And I'm not sure that it will, because I think all the interceptors have been taken out. Yes, they have. One interceptor in there, two in there. This is incredibly bad for the Protoss now, and I would detect a GG. He should have kept those carriers, he should have kept using those carriers and then backed up with the Dragoons and rushed in. He should not have lost the two Reavers. Terran did everything right, and Protoss was doing things right, but making blunders along the way, and I believe that's what cost him the game. And I think in that case, I believe that CJ is going to close out this game with a 3-0 victory. The main Nexus about to be taken out once he pushes towards the Stargates, which seems to be an inevitability. He will be leaving the game. You're taking the loss in this case. Keep in mind though, that the farther Terran pushes through this region, the more effective the carrier harassment will. However, he needs more interceptors, and he does not have enough interceptors. The Goliaths with the upgrade could simply take out the interceptor. Meanwhile, Terran is starting to swallow up the map at the top left. And damn, that's a lot of Goliaths on the way. And as the Terran push continues closer and closer and closer to the Stargates, we are really seeing how Terrans have really began to adapt to this map. GG! Dark Elf made that look easy. Being the Dark Elf that he is, the game is over. Pure has lost, and Fox will have to leave with a sad face on, as CJ has proven to be the dominant force in those games. Really taking the win over here for the one-on-ones. I have to say I'm absolutely impressed with CJ's performance. And unfortunately for Fox, they only managed to win the 2-on-2. It was just not enough. Dark Elf giving a respectful bow. He is a very skilled player indeed, as is the team CJ. He will gather up his keyboard and other things. We have seen some very exciting exhibition games over here for these two teams. The CJ, of course, and We Made Fox. And we also saw some excellent games earlier, which are all stored on the VODs. If you missed them, you can still check them out. They're still on the GOM website, as they will be for a while, with the team Hunbitsoft and Soul. So please check out those games if you haven't already. Tell your friends about it. We're going to have more games coming up on GOM TV, not now, but later. And I believe the next games we will be covering, which I think will be Sunday night Korean time. I don't know what time that will be for you, wherever you are in the world. It will be the Avratech Intel Classic from our wonderful Intel sponsors. Check out the Avratech PC, the number one selling PC in Asia. I thought we were going to end that, but I guess we're not. So here we are seeing the final score. As I said before, only 2-on-2s appear to be what Fox can win today. The rest of the games, CJ appears to have superior Zerg versus Protoss, Terran versus Terran, and a Terran versus Protoss. Unfortunately, we did not get to see that much Protoss action from CJ, but perhaps sometime in the future, we're going to have more exciting games coming up. Four more top players. They have not informed me of who the players will be on Sunday's matches. But this will, of course, be this is a very big tournament that we are running, the Avratel Intel Classic, with, I believe, over 100 players. Could be a little bit less. All pro gamers. So we're really leaving no stone unturned here. You're going to get to see a lot of different faces and a lot of different games all on these new maps, which is going to be very exciting. The Avratel Intel Classic is, in fact, has more money, more prize money poured into it than any other tournament in Korea, and I believe any other tournament in the world for that matter. And with that being said, you can count on these guys training very hard for this event in the hopes to qualify and make some cash. Even on the, I think, Sunday, we're going to be giving away $10,000 to the player who makes it out of his group of four. And with that being said, that's a lot of money. A lot of these OSL finals or MSL finals only have, what, like $40,000? So that just shows you how we don't mess around with this kind of stuff, ballers at GOM TV. So please tune in for that. It's been a real pleasure to be casting here for you down in Seoul, Korea. I cannot wait to cast some more games, and I believe we will have that in the future. And we'll be doing this every Sunday as well, so please tune on into that. And I think we're going to be closing up the show here in just a little bit. I just sit here and read the Korean commentator's body language. because I'm backstage right now. I will be on the stage, though, for the Sunday matches, and I'm very excited to reclaim my desk from We Made Fox. And what else can I tell you guys? To wind up the show, again, check out all of these games on the player. And remember, I don't believe the GOM player is compatible with Firefox yet. So if any of your friends are having any problems, that might be the issue. They need to use Internet Explorer. And again, it's been a real pleasure to cast with you all down here today. I expect more games in the future. And take care. Much love.